So what are we working for?
So you know we're not working for anything less than a complete transformation of the criminal legal system. I mean, we are a movement of defenders prepared to keep the promise. In a Florida prison, Clarence Earl Gideon tapped the tip of his pen to his temple. Mr. Gideon was intent on putting the finishing touches on a letter, a petition to the Supreme Court of the United States, asking them to review his case. In 1961, Gideon had been arrested and charged with breaking into a pool hall in Panama City, Florida. A witness claimed they saw Gideon leaving the pool room in the midnight hours with a bottle of wine and some money in his pocket. Police picked up Gideon just a little while later. Shortly after, Judge Robert McCrary Jr. eventually found Gideon guilty and sentenced him to 5 years behind a cage, the maximum sentence he could hand out. The United States is the top incarcerator in the world today. But things were different when Gideon was penning his petition in 62. There were only about 216,000 people locked up at any given moment that year, 10 times less than at this very moment. Our nation was right in the middle of the civil rights movement in 1962. Rosa had already refused to move to the back of the bus, igniting change in Montgomery. Same with the Greensboro Four at Woolworth's lunch counter in North Carolina, igniting change in the segregated spaces throughout the South. And the Arkansas National Guardsmen hadn't moved either, having been ordered by Governor Orval Faubus to block the entrance of the all-white Central High. Constitutionally entitled and federally protected, the Little Rock Nine eventually made their way through. Little Ruby Bridges did too. By 1962, the Freedom Riders had already touched the road to commemorate the 7th anniversary of Brown versus Board of Education, that legislation of school integration, challenging the status quo and the morality of segregation. It was on one of those rides at a station in South Carolina when John Lewis and Albert Bigelow were beaten with fists and their own suitcases by white folks who hadn't yet overcome their love of hatred. That wasn't even the last time or the most iconic time that John Lewis was beaten.
And people just start trampling over each other. The last thing I remember, I was just out on the ground and I thought I was going to die. I thought I saw God.
Mr. Gideon was handwriting his petition in 1962, the middle of this movement. Emmett had been murdered before Gideon's pen touched the pad. But the march hadn't yet crossed the Edmund Pettus Bridge. Martin hadn't yet shared his dream, and Malcolm hadn't yet been betrayed. John, Robert, Fred, and Metger were still preaching solidarity, not yet stolen away. And those four sweet little girls in Birmingham, they were still prepping their dresses for church on Sunday. This movement and those martyrs and the many, many named and unnamed others, their work led to influential policy changes. We've got the Executive Order 9981, signed by Truman, Brown versus Board of Education, decided by the Supreme Court in 1954, and the Civil Rights Act of 1957, signed by Eisenhower. President Johnson, who I think of as the flawed giant of civil rights, signed the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and the Fair Housing Act in 1968. Well, from a policy perspective, this is one of the reasons why I think of President Johnson as a flawed giant of civil rights. He pushed for and signed the Omnibus Crime Control and Safe Streets Act in 1968. This was formed in large part because of the uprising sparked by police brutality. and it unlocked an abundant federal funding to local police departments. And it opened a path to the militarization of, you know what? Let me just put it this way. If you know, you know. But for now, let's swing back to Mr. Clarence Earl Gideon. We're back in 1962 in a Florida state prison. Clarence Earl Gideon finished his petition and sent it off. It was against all odds that Mr. Gideon, a currently incarcerated, formerly incarcerated drifter from Hannibal, Missouri, with no money and no more than an eighth grade education, would eventually reach one of the most influential Americans to have ever lived. The Due Process Clause, he wrote to Chief Justice Earl Warren, of the 14th Amendment of the Constitution and the 5th and 6th Articles of the Bill of Rights has been violated. So look, Gideon couldn't afford a lawyer to defend him during his trial in 61, and the court did not appoint one to him. Appointing a public defender wasn't required by the Florida state law at the time. So he and thousands of others had to either defend themselves, a nearly impossible feat, or plead guilty, which is what most defendants did. Mr. Gideon attempted to represent himself, and he paid the price. So Clarence wondered, how could a trial be fair if he didn't have a qualified, competent defense attorney to protect him? Even though the Supreme Court of Florida denied his habeas corpus, the Supreme Court of the United States decided to review his case. The court ruled unanimously in favor of Clarence Earl Gideon in 1963. From that point on, people at every level of the criminal legal system were constitutionally promised representation whether or not they could afford a lawyer. The ruling afforded Gideon a new trial. And this time, he was represented by three appointed lawyers. Mr. Gideon was found not guilty on all charges. You see, his defenders kept the promise. Clarence Earl Gideon passed away in 1972 after changing the course of legal history. Etched on his gravestone is a line that he wrote to his lawyer many, many years before. A line that permeates our work here at Gideon's Promise. I believe that each era finds an improvement in the law for the benefit of mankind, he said. Our criminal legal system preys on the poor and perpetuates poverty. By providing training and support to current and aspiring public defenders, we help this nation uphold its promise of protection for all.